You should be all set.
So, Ian, what, you want to count me down, Ian?
Slow.
No one's sitting.
No one's there. That's
oh, yeah. Sure, it's
basement.
Sure. It's,
you know, one of our counselors resigned after 4 months.
This is cool, huh? Brand new furniture?
Yeah.
Their
oh, yeah.
Is a little narrow for us.
Still.
Those guys.
It's yeah, you just give me a 5 sec, five count.
Still some discretion.
It's good for me to have.
Our yeah, there is. To the manager.
Yep. Then gets one and give one to Counselor Murphy and one to myself.
Yeah, it's been contentious, to say the least.
Step right up here and sign up, people.
All this good stuff.
Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting, July 14th, 2016. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight, and I will be presiding tonight. Thank you to the public who has managed to not quite dodge raindrops in order to get in tonight. I appreciate that. And I'm sorry if it's too cold here. I understand the air conditioning. We have a lot of members in the audience who are quite wet. I also have the sign-up sheet, which is also wet. We're going to, before we start our meeting, we're going to do what we as is our custom, to hear from the public in the public comments section. And briefly, the rules are, please keep your comments to 3 minutes or under. You're under no obligation to meet all 3 minutes at all. Also, when you come up, please state your name and address. Also, understand that under our rules that we're not allowed to respond. We will listen attentively. This is your opportunity to speak. We do plenty of speaking as it is, but please don't pose any questions. At least you can pose questions, but please don't expect answers and don't feel that you're being ignored because we don't respond. Also, I'd ask that you subscribe to the decorum of the chambers and consider the fact that there's a possibility of defaming someone when you speak. You can defame us. We're elected officials. We're fair game. Just don't cuss, but you can call us anything else short of cussing. And other people, please remember that they are not the public figures that we are, and so please keep that in check if you're so inclined. With that, with all those caveats, we're going to start with Fred Zimnock, who's been here since 6:30.
Thank you very much, Council President. My name is Fred Zimnock. I'm from Ward 3B, Honorable City Councilors. Concerning elimination of Public Works Commission as a multiple member body, the mayor writes, the elimination of Public Works Commission does not eliminate an ongoing future role of citizen advisors on matters affecting public works. To the contrary, it is my intention to continue to utilize the talents and energy of citizens advisory roles on public matter, public works related issues, whether on the reuse committee, public shade tree committee, or transportation parking commission, capital improvement committee, or other issue specific roles. I knew that the Board of Public Works was eliminated and replaced by the Public Works Commission. I have not seen any documents describing their mission and responsibilities, but assume that the mission and responsibilities would be identical to the BPW, except that they would not be responsible for setting water and sewer rates. Be that as it may, I think it would be worthwhile to review the responsibilities of the old BPW that was defined lastly in Chapter 53 of the old city charter that was approved in June of 1992. It included merging the Cemetery Commission with the BPW, composed of citizen advisors. Most important historically for the city is Bridge Street Cemetery, whose history goes back to our earliest times. While it could be said that Bridge Street Cemetery is simply a graveyard with stone markers, these markers are effectively touchstones to the lives of the people who created the remarkable history of not only our city, but our state and our nation. These touchstones evoke the lives and actions of senators, representatives, governors, religious leaders, veterans of several wars, and citizens who have contributed to our city and our country in notable and beneficial ways. Much time could be spent on the lives of just a few of these permanent residents. One permanent resident is Captain Luke Day. As a Shaysite, on the morning of August 29th, 1786, he led about 500 men down Bridge Street in a successful attempt to prevent the sitting of the Court of Common Pleas at Clark's Tavern. This action was to avoid foreclosure of their farm mortgages, since they were becoming insolvent under the new taxation to pay for the war that we couldn't afford. This and their later actions led Alexander Hamilton to create a national bank, to market bonds, to pay for the cost of the country's war. So now, the wealthy of Boston, who purchased military scrip from our fighting men for, quote, shillings on the pound, unquote, could redeem their scrip at face value. Is that 3 minutes?
Yeah. Sorry, Fred.
Oh, anyway, my suggestion was to restore the commission for the cemetery.
And if you would be so kind as to submit
I'll send that to you.
I appreciate that. Thanks so much. Next up is Roy C. Mart.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen of City Council, ladies and gentlemen of the audience and at home, and Mr. Mayor. Tonight I come before you because I have several different...
Roy, identify yourself and say your
address. I am Roy C. Martin, 81 Conn Street, Northampton, Massachusetts, apartment 529.
Thank you.
Good enough. Tonight I come before you because I have several issues. One issue is the paper bags. Now, I can see no reason why we have paper bags. Well, look at the weather tonight. All right, now people going out of Stop and Shop with paper bags and everything falls out the bottom because the paper bag is soaking wet. All right, and another thing, right? Every time you use a paper bag, right, there's pulpwood involved. Right, pulpwood to make paper to go in the paper bag. Now, every time that you use the pulpwood, there's a tree cut down. Every time there's a tree cut down, that greenery goes. And when that greenery goes, you have problems with breathing and stuff like that. Your oxygen, right? The oxygen in the air comes from your trees. And I see less trees around here. All right, up there at the VA, they're taking down all the good trees, all the good greenery and everything. All right, and there's more people with breathing problems. And I'm one of them, right? I have breathing problems. I use an inhaler, and I use oxygen at home. But I just can't see why we're cutting down so many trees and why we're using paper bags in this city when just over in Springfield they're using plastic, right? In Holyoke they're using plastic. I know I heard, right, you know, that they're going to try to use paper over there in Holyoke. All right, I think Morris is crazy if he gets something like that in. And now that was one issue, right? Now there's another issue with the parking administration. Parking administration, all right, goes down into the Selvo House parking lot, which has no parking meters now, mind you. We don't have parking meters there. And it's private parking. Every tenant has a parking space and everything. All right, and so they start giving out tickets in the Selvo House. All right, now, this money that's on the tickets in the Selvo House is what? It goes to the parking administration. Parking administration goes to Boston and everything else, right? You know, we don't get it back. It don't go to the Tenants Association. It don't go down to Northampton Housing Authority or anything, right? That money is just wasted, you know, right? Here's $150 here, all right, you know? You know, we could use it back if we got it. Now, that's another thing, all right? And then, you know, I have several different things that I have to bring up, but, you know, I'm watching the clock there, and I got like 20, you know, 19 seconds left. And, you know, there's a lot of things that I just don't believe in this city. You know, you people of the city council, you work so hard on everything, right? Let's start working on the budget. Start working on how we're going to make money to pay taxes without raising taxes.
Thank you very much, Roy.
It's up to you people, the city council.
Thank you. Jenny Fleming Ives.
Bill, I think James is going to, we're swift.
James Lowenthal, then.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm James Lowenthal, 181 Crescent Street. I'm here to address the city's plan to replace all of our current streetlights, 2,000 of them, with new LED streetlights. Why is this important? I put on your desks this new report from the American Medical Association that is a quick read. It's only a few pages long. It summarizes the very serious adverse effects of light at night, especially excess light from strong LEDs. These include disruption of sleep, elevated rates of obesity, elevated rates even of diabetes and of cancer. That's only for the human side. It also affects wildlife. Obviously, it robs us of the beauty of the night sky, and there are safety effects as well. Light that is not well designed, generally light that is very glaring, is a safety hazard for drivers and pedestrians and bicyclists. So kudos to the city for taking the time to solicit public feedback on the test lights that were installed on Pleasant Street and the surrounding areas. And especially to the mayor and the councilors who are on the Energy and Sustainability Committee for going back again and putting in a new test at the request of over 100 petitioners back in May. The new test was a different brand. The first kind was Leotech. The second kind was Cree. Some of us had a hope that the Cree would be much better, would have less glare. No such luck. Very disappointed to see what you'll see on this other handout here. These are photographs of the old lights that have been in place for more than 20 years. These are photographs of the new lights that show you how much glare there is. It's blinding glare. If you go down, don't take my word for it, go down to William Street and take a look. So what can we do about it? We can add a shield, a glare shield. The brand that the city chose, Leotech, there's an optional glare shield that I urge the city to install on every single one of those lights. How does it work? It works like this. Basically, the light is made of LEDs on a flat panel like this. It's very, very bright. It's, you know, 10 times brighter than this, literally. And if you mount this 25 feet high and look at it from anywhere within about 300 feet, you'll see these LEDs directly. This is exactly what the AMS says you don't want to do. You want to shield those LEDs from direct view. How do you do it? You take a little shield and you attach it like that. Now the light goes down only where it's supposed to be, where it's useful, without blinding drivers and pedestrians, and without shining into people's houses and disrupting their sleep. You might ask, well, how much does this cost? Isn't this going to be terribly prohibitively expensive? This doesn't cost anything. But the Leotech one, I've actually ordered four of them myself at $35 a piece. That would add 7% to the total cost of the project. My suggestion, take that 7% by removing 7% of the lights, and you can start with the one outside my house. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Nicely timed. Jenny, do you want to speak now? Okay.
Okay. Good evening, City Council. Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah, the mic.
You're okay?
Yep.
It's going. Jenny Fleming Eyes, I'm in 15 Dryads Green. Good evening, all of you, and the mayor. And I'm here to follow up on James. As a healthcare professional, I'm very concerned about the impact of glare and lights, especially at night, with migraine issues and people's overall health. And so I'm here really to encourage you to think about installing these shields on all of the city lights. I know at the moment the plan was case-by-case basis, but that entails people to make the effort, understand, and request that. And I think that's rather unfair I also think it would be rather tacky to have some with glare lights, with glare shields, and some not. So I really encourage you, and I'm, you know, applauding what James said about maybe reducing the number and covering the cost that way. So that's me.
Thank you very much. And Jaskat, please.
Hi, I'm Ann Jaskat. Thanks for allowing me to speak. I'm on 405 Florence Road, and I'm here also to add my voice in favor of adding shields to the lights. I think it would improve the appearance of our city, as well as helping the comfort and health of our residents. Looking at the new lights as they're currently installed, they do indeed have a lot of glare. You can even see reflections of them in some of the upper story windows. So it's clearly, that light is clearly reaching those people, the residents who live in the upper floors. And in walking around at night, looking at the lights, I even heard completely unprompted from somebody who shouted down to me from an upper floor window about how much he hates the new lights. So I certainly wouldn't want to sleep near them myself. And I think that the simple snap-on shield is a very simple fix for this exact problem. There's a growing scientific consensus, as James said, that light at night can be harmful for your health by disrupting sleep cycles and increasing cancer risk, and this is a responsible and straightforward solution. In addition, it will help the safety of drivers and pedestrians. Especially when I first moved here, I've had a number of close calls with pedestrians because of glare while driving at night, as people just walk across the street without stopping. And it's very difficult to see them if glare is in your eyes. But again, if you have shields, that directs the light downward to the pedestrians and not out into my eyes as the driver. And it will not. It will also keep the light downwards and not from illuminating people's houses. So I urge the City Council to consider the option of shields. And I think I'm glad that we're going to gain the benefit of cost saving from these new lights. And I think that we can kind of have the best of both worlds by also reducing their glare. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Janet Gross, please.
Greetings, Janet Gross, 38 Round Hill Road, and more about lights. The test lights on Pleasant and Holyoke Street are too bright. Their glare far too harsh. Last night we attempted to view the two new bulbs, but only one was on. If Northampton is to install the ones we observed or similar LEDs, shields are necessary on every fixture. And I'd go further. The development atop Round Hill introduced us to the Sing Sing-like horrors of inappropriate LEDs. Although some bulbs have been dimmed or turned off, others remain, and new ones recently appeared. Their presence is apparently due to a now outdated Cambridge ordinance that had allowed old light fixtures to be grandfathered without regard to the impact of their new bulbs. Last year, Cambridge revised its ordinance. It's time for Northampton to do the same. Whether on public or private property, owners must be required to use LEDs responsibly, with mindful regard for their impact on the health and well-being of neighbors, neighborhoods, and community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ruthie Woodring, please.
Ruthie Woodring, 8 High Street, Florence. I wish I'd written something, but my head is spinning. I agree with all the stuff they said about the lights. I really like to see them shielded. The other thing that's been on my mind as I was writing down here was, you know, thinking about the events of the last couple of weeks, or the publicized events of the last couple of weeks against people of color. Just think about light and darkness, and isn't Northampton light enough already? And can we embrace the textures and different soft colors of the darkness? Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's all I have signed up. Is there anyone who hasn't had an opportunity to speak who would like to speak? Also, if you're here for a planning board meeting, I'm sorry, but that's in the building. It's in the City Hall, the second floor. So just a okay. No takers. Okay. Well, then I'm going to ask the administrative assistant to please call the roll so that we can convene.
Councilor Bidwell.
Here.
Councilor Carney.
Present.
Councilor White.
Here.
Councilor Klein.
Here.
Councilor LeBarge.
Present.
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Shara.
Here.
We have a quorum, therefore we can convene. To start off with, we have a public hearing. This is regarding a petition from National Grid to erect poles and wires upon, along, under, or across Round Hill Road. This is in accordance with the provisions of Section 22, Chapter 166 of the General Laws. Public hearing will be held on the petition of National Grid to erect poles and wires upon, along, under, or across Round Hill Road, as we said. So, first I'll ask.
Move to open the hearing.
Thank you very much. Is there a second? All those in favor of opening the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. To start with, we will hear from the proponents. Lisa, if you want.
Good evening, members of the council. Lisa Jasinski with National Grid. I'm here to request the relocation of a pole on Round Hill Road. I'm sorry if it's pole number one or pole number two. Right now, as you go up Round Hill Road, it's just beyond the sidewalk. We actually want to move it down to the green space before the sidewalk. With the work that's going to be done at Smith College, we had an anchor to hold all the construction that goes up Round Hill Road. And to put that anchor, it would be in the new sidewalk that's going to be going in. So we're going to anchor it at that first pole at Round Hill Road. It just means moving it back towards Elm Street a little bit, not close to Elm Street, but towards Elm Street, so that we can get an anchor in there and hold that construction going up Round Hill Road.
Are there any opponents or who are interested in speaking to this poll? Any questions from the council? Motion to close the hearing. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Okay, the hearing is closed. Thank you, Lisa, very much.
Thank you.
Move to approve and
burn it. It's on the consent agenda.
Oh,
so,
it is.
Yeah. Yeah.
How good is that?
Next up, we have a public hearing. This is regarding the administrative order to amend Administrative Code Part 2, Sections 20.02. This is the Public Works Commission, 23.0 is Public Shade Tree Commission. And Section 1.03, Appointment of Elected Officials to Serve on Multiple Member Bodies. And Part 1, Section 6, which is the Public Works Division. I'll accept a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? We'll hear from proponents first. I suspect it will be the mayor. Do you want to speak to you?
I'm not public.
You're the proposer, yeah. But you are a proponent. So I don't know. The public is also, anyone from the public who's interested in speaking to this point? Okay.
There's no one signed up on the list.
Why don't we hold, we have a special meeting within the contents of this meeting, so maybe we'll reserve the council questions at that point for you. How's that? Okay, we'll accept the motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Now we're up to communications proclamations from the mayor. That's mayor's concern.
Right. 1 minute.
Oh boy, I just leaped over the 1 minute announcement. I'm sorry. Anyone have 1 minute announcements? Any counselors? Anything they want to share? Oh, come on. No? Okay. All right. Now we leap ahead to communications proclamations from the mayor. This is to consider a request of the mayor that the city council invoke Article 3, Section 3-7 of the Northampton Charter and pursuant to Article 3, Section 3-7. A, to determine by a roll call vote whether the mayor will be unable to perform the duties of the office during an upcoming trip abroad. The mayor wants to go on vacation. Your Honor.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the council. I tried to outline for you in the letter both the section of the charter that I would ask you to invoke, as well as the other information. You are correct, Mr. President. Although I'm not just going a couple of towns over, I am leaving the country. My family and I are going to on a trip. Some of you may know that my wife's mom passed away this last fall, and we are going back to Montenegro, which is where she's from and where her parents are. Uh, her her grandparents are buried, and aunts and uncles are there, and so we're bringing her ashes back to Montenegro. It's also where my wife is. My wife is from from Serbia, but the former Yugoslavia. So it's all, they used to all be one country, and now they're separate countries. So because I'll be leaving the country, because I'll be in a few different time zones away, I thought it would be prudent to ask you to invoke this particular section of the charter now, rather than an emergency arises and there may be some indispensable issue that can't wait till I return, and then you'd have to call an emergency meeting or something like that. As is spelled out in the charter, the powers of the acting mayor are for just those powers that are indispensably essential to conduct the business of the city in an orderly, efficient manner, in which action may not be delayed. So, if there were some sort of an emergency and it would take me 2.5 to 3 days to get back here, this would allow the council president to be able to take any actions in my absence. So,
great. Excellent.
The acting.
As I recall, actually, the only time in my memory that this has been invoked, at least for emergency powers, is when Mayor Higgins was away and there was a microburst on Pine Street, on Pine Brook Curve, actually. And Council President Bardsley was ostensibly in charge of emergency management. And I would say to the public, just as an aspect of reassurance, I would not be in charge of emergency management. Very highly trained people would be in charge of emergency management, but I would be there in order to.
Well, there was a need, for example, for a declaration of emergency,
yes,
which the emergency manager cannot sign.
Right.
You would be able to sign that.
Right.
Those kinds of functions will be, obviously we have professionals that are here to
right.
take care of us.
I thought it was important to give that assurance so
definitely.
That we have a mass
yeah.
exodus for the
yeah.
2 weeks. That,
and this is an area that the charter has sort of clarified because it was a little bit ambivalent in the last charter.
Right.
And of course, I was acting mayor during the great October
right.
snowstorm,
right.
which you may remember, the great Halloween snowstorm.
This is why I'm
power for a few days.
Living
so.
A certain amount of
yeah.
anxiety at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And again, there are no council meetings or school committee meetings or any other meetings scheduled
right.
during that. So I don't think it will present a conflict to the council president.
And I will not be signing any contracts. I will not be making any hires or firing anybody.
Yeah.
This power is actually that those powers are not defined into this. So just so everyone understands what's going to happen here. Any questions of the mayor relative to this?
No. Will you have an NCTV crew following you and documenting your vacation?
No, I think we'll take pictures. We'll probably you'll probably see it on Facebook or Twitter or something. Yeah, it's a really special and beautiful place. We went there once about 7 or 8 years ago when my kids were really young, it's a very and again, my wife was born there. And then used to go back during the summers, and then of course the wars all broke out for several years. So the airport we flew into, got blown up in the war. So it had to have been rebuilt over time. So so we're going back, and we aunts and uncles there, and other cousins, and new babies that have been born that we haven't ever seen before. So it'll be special in that regard, and also being able to return. My mother-in-law's ashes and bury them with her parents in the family cemetery. So, and it's a little bit of a trip to get there, so it's not a one-weeker, so that's why we took a little bit extra time. Yeah.
Councilor Shara.
As there's a half hour for people to run down to the registrar's office to register to vote, will you be getting an absentee ballot?
I will. I definitely have already inquired since, of course, I will be back the day after the special election. So yes, I will be. And I believe the drawing was just held to set the order of the ballot. So I know that the city clerk has ordered the ballots. So hopefully the absentee ballots will be in. I guess I could request one by mail. I have requested an absentee ballot, but thank you. It's a good reminder to anyone out there who's going to be on vacation during that period.
That period would be August 4th, which is scheduled election time. So if you're not going around and you want to vote, file for your absentee ballot. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other? Oh, Councilor LeBarge.
Yes, Mayor. I want to wish you and your family a very, very safe trip mm-hmm. and enjoy your vacation.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Councilor. And again, I will be reachable by, you know, email and phone, and in the case of dire emergency. But I'm going to try to enjoy it after this.
It's not on the agenda. Oh, okay. Well, Pam informs me that we need a vote on this. So,
one vote.
Councilor.
Do we need a formal motion?
Yes. We need a formal motion.
So can I move that the City Council determines that for this period of time, the mayor would be unable to perform the duties of the office?
Yeah. Being voted.
That, and that's language coming from this section of the charter, which I think would fulfill our responsibility.
Is there a second? Okay. Any discussion?
And just even though that sounds so absolute, obviously, we've discussed how, you know, the mayor will be following what's happening in city government and to the extent possible. And yeah, it's a precaution more than
he is. Yes, as seemingly possible. I will be in town, though. Any other discussion?
We'll be in Holyoke.
Well, I'll visit Holyoke. It's a wonderful place. It's where I'm from. Any further discussion? Does this require a roll call?
Yes.
Well, it's okay.
Yes.
Roll
yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara. Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
And as a further note, actually, I believe that under that authority, I do not have the authority to vote on the council as I serve the acting mayor, I believe under the language of the charter.
But there's no meeting.
There will be no meetings, but if we should have an emergency meeting, which we seem to have a rash of lately, but during a period in which any member of the city council serving as acting mayor, that councilor shall not vote as a member of the city council. Right.
And those ambiguities in the previous charter.
Right. Yeah. There were some discussions of that effect.
I was, the acting mayor was presiding as.
Right. As the
council president was presiding as acting mayor. Yeah. So.
Okay. Now we're going to have two recesses. Normally we recess for finance committee, but now because. I'm sorry. I keep leaping ahead by one item. The Catholic Charities is here, representatives from the Catholic Charities, and they're going to do a presentation on a topic that's been much discussed locally. This is bringing refugees into Northampton, and we have Susanna Crolius here.
Hello, counselors. I am Susanna Crolius. I'm the coordinator of outreach for Catholic Charities Office of Immigration, Migration, and Refugee Services. I also want to introduce Catherine Buckley Bronner, who is the executive director of Catholic Charities, who is here this evening as well. I put this disclaimer up on this first slide because there's no way we're going to be able to get everything said that we need to say in 6 minutes. But I do want to give you just a little bit of context. We'll go very quickly through these slides.
No, you're just going to hit the left.
There you go.
Just very quickly, some statistics. We were asked to give some context in case you are not familiar with the situation or the depth of the situation that's going on. There are 65 million forcibly displaced people in the world. 6 months ago, this number was 60 million, and so this number is increasing. Of those 65 million people, 15 to 17 million will be officially classified through UNHCR as refugees, and of those 15 to 17 million people who will have that status, 1%, actually less than 1% of these, are about 150,000 people, will be resettled to 28 countries around the world. So that is the global context in which we begin this conversation. There is a whole process, an international process, a national, a global process, a regional process. I will not go into those details now. just to say that we locally, regionally, in Western Massachusetts, there are currently two agencies that resettle refugees, and they have focused being in the greater Springfield area. And the communities that have been resettled in that area are quite diverse: Iraq, Somalia, Burundi, Congo, Bhutan, Ukraine, Moldova, and Syrian refugees. Just a bit about Catholic Charities. Catholic Charities is the largest resettling agency of refugees in the country. Our office is not, but Catholic Charities nationally is the largest resettler of refugees. About a quarter of refugees resettled get resettled through Catholic Charities. Catholic Charities in Springfield is a social services agency whose mission is to assist and empower the most vulnerable citizens to move toward stabilization. Catholic Charities in Springfield has recently applied to become what is called a reception and placement agency. Now, question, why would we do this? Because the number of refugees coming to the United States is increasing. The cap on the number of refugees that are being resettled has been raised, and these families are coming to the United States and around the world. We were asked by the Catholic Conference of Bishops and Migrant and Refugee Services if we would consider resettling refugees who are slated to come to the United States. We know that the greater Springfield area is home already to many thousands of refugees, and Catholic Charities was very intentional in not wanting to resettle people where resources are already stretched to capacity. The Northampton City Council passed a resolution welcoming refugees in December of 2015. And so we asked the question, what would it look like to welcome refugees into a community that wanted them, embraced them, were creative thinkers, and had the capacity and resources to imagine with us a new way of resettling refugees so that they and the community thrives? And so that's where we are now. There have been meetings what are we talking about here? We're talking about reselling refugees. Catholic Charities is inviting the city of Northampton to partner in welcoming 51 refugees, individuals. That's 10 to 17 families to make their home here in Northampton. We have requested that these refugees would come from Syria, Afghanistan, Burundi, or Congo. The first families could arrive in January 2017. All 51 people would not arrive at once, but over the course of the fiscal year. I have given you copies of the PowerPoint. We have an objective, which is a seamless community-based infrastructure that supports and empowers newly arrived refugees, builds capacity in the period after their 90 days, and sustains learning and integration through citizenship, which is at 5 years and beyond. That is what we are asking the community to partner with us in creating this seamless and community-based initiative. And that's the important word here, community-based initiative. This vision is a tiered approach that empowers and builds communities focusing on newly arrived refugees, and then of course the post 90-day period, which is a cutoff point for the federal government, and then ongoing. And what makes our initiative community-based is that we are asking folks to walk with refugee families for an extended period of time through circles of care, through, we know that refugees don't thrive when they are isolated. If we can create a community-based initiative where refugees are welcomed and walked through all the many points along their way towards integration, then they do in fact thrive. Uh, Just quickly, we have met with city councilors, with two city councilors. We've met with the mayor. We had a gathering of community leaders on June 11th. Faith leaders have been in this conversation. There is now what's called a Welcome Home Steering Group that is formed of community leaders who will be forming a framework for how this would look and might work. From those steering groups, there will be working groups that will be forming that will tackle the practical issues involved in refugee resettlement. There are house parties forming that will be places of education. And then there will be a public conversation, we think in about September, where the community will be able to engage in this. And there is an ongoing community education strategy to learn more about this. These are just, so the Welcome Home Steering Group, purpose to explore and build community-based infrastructure within the Northampton community for effective resettlement of refugee neighbors. And so this Welcome Home Steering Group has met once. We are breaking into working groups, focusing on the issues of housing, the school system, employment, circles of care, and ongoing public education. And very quickly, timeline, the fiscal year to the federal government resettlement program's fiscal year begins on October 1st. We have requested our first families to perhaps come in January 2017. Again, not all will come at once. The steering group members and the working group are working on this, we have some things that we need to do together as a community between now and January 2017. The issue of identifying appropriate housing, identifying employers and apprenticeships for refugees, creating circles of care, training them and getting them ready to go, talking with the school system about what it needs and feels confident in to serve students, and really getting buy-in from the Northampton community, because this is, again, community-based. And what I'm asking you as city councilors to do, what can you do? We are looking for people to join these working groups, the housing, the employment, the volunteers, the public education. And so you all have expertise and connections that would be valuable to the working groups. Get informed with the facts. We are happy at Catholic Charities to provide facts. There are lots and lots and lots and lots of misinformation out there. We can help you with the facts. And what we'll do is get some language for you that will be helpful in understanding what the facts are. I encourage you to really listen to people. This is an anxiety-producing issue. It is multifaceted. It is complex. It is definitely not black and white. And so we all need to just listen to everybody in this. So I encourage you to please really listen to folks. And begin to ask around about potential housing situations and or employers or artisans who would consider hiring refugees. We're getting the ball going. And if you have any questions, if I or Catherine could be helpful in any way, please do not hesitate to contact me. Thank you.
That's very impressive, Susanna. You did that in 6 minutes, I have to say. Any questions? Councilors have any questions? Or Dennis?
I was just curious, based on experience in other communities, you refer to 20 units of appropriate housing. What's the type of housing that has tended to be most appropriate?
So we're discovering that we are in the process of finding out the scope and the bounds of that. We are in conversation with Migrant and Refugee Services and the State Department about what constitutes appropriate housing. We are getting some answers back about that because, as I say, we have to be creative about this. This is a creative, innovative project that we are asking us all to embark on. In the time that I have, I don't have time to be specific about that, but we are getting the scope of that, and we'll have clarity about what is appropriate housing and what can be creatively worked with.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes. Thank you for this presentation. I had received some calls of concerns from some residents on my ward about 50 refugee strategies coming here to the city of Northampton, and where are we going to find homes for them? Also, the cost of educating them. So I think it's extremely important that the residents living in this city are really educated about exactly what you're talking about tonight.
Thank you. I think we heard from the steering committee, and I'm hearing from you, that education.
Right. And it's needed.
It's absolutely needed. So thank you. We are tending to that.
Other questions? I think it's important to put this in some context, actually, as you described. That's a very small amount of people that actually will receive services. In fact, the cap was originally at 10,000 refugees that the President Obama was willing to accept, right, for the United States. And that
has increased the cap. It's been at 70,000 for many years, has increased it this year to 85,000, of which 10,000 of those will be Syrian refugees. And then next fiscal year, raising the cap to 100,000.
But I think, you know, if you look at that proportionally, 100,000 people, that you would disappear in a that's a small town, a decent sized town. In the same, by the same token, 51 residents, of which you say between 10, 16, 17 families, in a community of 29,000, is also easily absorbed. And in fact, actually, we see that kind of transition occur on a regular basis and without noticing. But you're right, and Councilor LaBarge is right, there's been kind of a visceral response that clearly we have to address, abating some of the concerns that spontaneously arise, which actually do have clear answers. I mean, that's to your credit, Catholic Charities. You've been annealed in past fires, so you're well prepared.
Yes.
For explaining the process and the impact. And I think people are concerned about the impact, and sometimes people discuss, you know, why are we focusing on refugees when there are homeless people and people in need here now? Mm-hmm. And I think it's important to point out that these are not mutually exclusive endeavors, and that nor should they be. And one does not suffer as a result of the other. There's not a prescribed amount of a little bit of charity that we've got, and then we don't want to expend all that charity and want for one particular group. So I'm grateful for, I've been edified by my conversations with you, inspired, you guys, and it is comforting to know that by and large your response in the main has been enthusiastic, not only just accepting and tolerant, it's been enthusiastic. So I'm proud of my town. So so you have my commitment to work with you on this. So, and I know Councilor Klein as well, for sure. Councilor Klein's been leading the way on this issue. So, and the mayor as well. So I think you have a receptive audience here. I'm not going to speak for all the councilors, but by and large, I mean, from informal conversations, I think that you do have a receptive community and a receptive government body. So
thank you. Well, we certainly recognize that we are not wearing rose-colored glasses. None of us are. There are challenges, and we have intentionally approached Northampton because we believe that it is the kind of community that can be creative and innovative with us in this.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes. When is the next meeting that you're having?
Well, the steering, we haven't set the next steering committee group meeting, but that will happen soon, and the working groups will be starting also.
And the
very
one
soon.
Thing that we have to be conscious of as counselors, I appreciate and understand the enthusiasm for counselors wanting to participate, but remember, we have to be careful of quorum issues. Insofar as not all these meetings will necessarily be public, because they're designed to be able to prepare for public presentation. So if we have a quorum of counselors, therefore it would automatically have to be a public meeting.
Right.
So
that's what I'm saying. So why couldn't you do that by putting city council and their committee?
There may be a time for that. I don't see why that wouldn't be appropriate, but I think in the initial stages where this is being, where everyone's trying to get their ducks in a row, I think we would end up doing more harm than good. That's not to preclude you from participating. I'm just saying as a warning that if it looks like there's a quorum of any subcommittee or a quorum of the council in general, that we should be careful and negotiate that. That's all, among ourselves. So, Councilor Klein.
I think there are, I'm gonna kind of speak for you a little bit and you can stop me and correct me if I'm getting this wrong, but there are gonna be opportunities for councilors to be engaged, because there are gonna be a series of house parties that are in the works right now. And it would be really wonderful, in fact, to have, I think, one or two councilors at the different house parties to show the folks that are coming from the community that the city council is supporting these efforts. And to also just listen to the concerns and listen to the questions that people have. I think it'll be helpful for us, and I think it'll be helpful for the process. And then just to kind of draw a little bit of a finer point on that piece about the community meetings, there is a vision that there will be two, you know, big kind of mass community meetings at different points after the house parties are done, and that would be in the fall, mid to late fall.
We're waiting for confirmation on dates on those, but the conversation, the locations have been discussed, and we're waiting on confirmation of those dates. Mid-September is what we're looking at.
Councilor Scherer.
Councilor Klein, are the house parties being organized by ward or in some sort of way that we could kind of logically attend them and avoid quorum issues?
We are thinking about kind of making sure that we're getting all the quadrants of the city. I haven't thought about it ward, but we're definitely looking at kind of geographically how to spread out, and also thinking about people who have different kind of social circles and colleagues, and so that we're trying to get kind of as broad a spectrum of people as possible. But there may be a way to kind of think about that geographically so that councilors can kind of go to the parties that happen in their ward. So thank you for that suggestion. We'll think about that a little bit more.
Any other questions? Comments? Catherine, oh, did you want to speak?
Go. Just want to say thank you. On behalf of Catholic Charities of the Diocese of Springfield, we want to thank you for the opportunity, and we want to thank you also for being so open and to already listening. So we ask you to keep listening, but we realize that you have been listening all the way along. So thank you very much.
Thank you both so much. Thanks
thank
a lot.
You.
Okay. Now we're going to recess. One of two recesses that we're going to have. This recess is actually to... by way of explanation, the City Council is on a foreshortened schedule. We only meet once a month for July and August. And as a result, that creates opportunities to be creative. So at this point, we're going to recess for the City Council Committee on Public Works and Utilities, which is chaired by Councilor Bidwell. And this is to discuss the article that came, the administrative order that came out of that public hearing that you witnessed just recently. So I am going into recess, and I defer to Councilor Bidwell to preside over his meeting.
Okay, thank you. The meeting of the Committee on Public Works and Utilities is called to order, and the administrative assistant would call the roll.
Councilor Bidwell?
Here.
Councilor Dwight?
Here.
Councilor Murphy?
Here.
We start all of our committee meetings, including a rather different one like this, with opportunities for public comment. Is there any member of the public that would like to address the meeting of this committee? And we'll, if you're addressing the matter on, if you're addressing the matter on the agenda, we'll get to that in just a minute. This is just anything other than that. I don't see any other public comments. So our first order of business is to approve the minutes of our meeting of June 27th, which have been distributed. And before that vote, I will just point out that at that meeting, we had a pretty robust discussion of the role going forward of the of this committee in light of the fact that the Public Works Commission is in the process of being disbanded. So there was some comment about that in public comment. So if anybody would like to sort of get a good summary of that conversation that we had, including the mayor, it's in those minutes.
I move that we approve the minutes.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
So next we have a petition 16.064, petition to discontinue a portion of Elm Street, referred to the committee on May 5th. And by way of background, and we'll hear a little bit more about this, but this matter was referred to the Planning Board on May 12th. They unanimously recommended approval. It went to the Public Works Commission on June 29th. They, too, recommended approval. And we do have a representative, one or two, from Smith here, Smith College tonight, which is it's their project, very much involved in this. Would you care to provide a brief background?
I filed a petition on behalf of the college, but Diana Randall, who is project manager, is here if you have questions. In reality, just to give you the scope of it, years ago, Elm Street was relocated further to the north, and the gates that you now see, which are 70 feet from Elm Street, used to be on Elm Street. It was to straighten out the street. The college wanted to move those gates back towards Elm Street and are replacing the utilities there, which are now, of course, responsibility of the city in the public way, but Smith will assume those if the public way is continued. That's the scope of the project. If you have specific questions, Diana Randall could certainly ask them, answer them for you.
Are there any questions from committee members or anyone else?
I would move approval and put it on the floor.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Now, is there any discussion? Given that it's been very well vetted, I'm not surprised. So unless there's any other question or comment, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. So that takes care of the discontinuance of Elm Street. The other item was a petition to accept a portion of Pleasant Street, referred to our committee June 2nd. And that, too, got a unanimous positive recommendation from the Planning Board on June 23rd and from the Public Works Commission on June 29th. And I don't know if, Mr. Mayor, you want to offer a very brief summary of what this is about.
Yeah, this is about Mass DOT has had a standing offer with the city to discontinue basically give the city its portion of Pleasant Street, pretty much running right up to the flood wall, or actually just a little bit before their yard there. We've been working with them over time, and this is a segment that we are prepared to accept at this point. There have been some other issues, including the building of the roundabout, because we have an agreement that we would not accept that intersection in its current state, and they are building the roundabout, the state's funding it, and then at some future point we would come forward with that. But this is a section that we're recommending to be accepted now, and obviously we have a number of plans for trying to, as part of our overall vision for Pleasant Street, to try to make some improvements on this particular section of Pleasant Street. So this will help by accepting mm-hmm. it as a city street.
And so to clarify, this is not the roundabout section.
No, this is not.
That would
all
come later.
This is not at all. Yeah.
Question.
As you said, I mean, this is the discussion has been that this is the gateway, so the Pleasant Street gateway, essentially, in that area.
Yeah.
For the person's first encounter with downtown Northampton is a rule that once they survive the roundabout. So we have been precluded from doing any kind of enhancements or improvements because of the DOT's authority over the property.
Well, it's their roadway, and so it's also an oddity because they basically, you know, their yard is right there, right. You know, just right near right when you come off of, you know, the highway,
right.
And then they sort of plow to a certain point, and then they sort of their roadway ends and Pleasant Street begins. So it's always been kind of a strange ending point for where the state road ends and the city's road begins. And they've been offering to discontinue or to basically to allow us to accept it. There had been some environmental issues that's why we didn't readily accept it. There were some environmental issues that we wanted to see taken care of.
Any issues or
what's that? Some environmental issues that we wanted them to do all of the investigations and make sure that it was clean. And then you may also recall that there's some other environmental issues closer down to, you know, where Pleasant Journey and the, and so there's some additional stuff there. And then obviously there's the roundabout. So we're doing this incrementally, but this is a section that is cleared for us to accept. And obviously the DPW is supportive and the planning board is supportive. And it, again, it's part of the overall, plan for the Pleasant Street corridor where we could begin to add some bicycle and pedestrian accommodations, et cetera, and some public park space. And the councilor may want to even speak to this because it's in his ward.
Councilor Donald.
Yeah, I would. And insofar as accepting or taking over this part of a state highway helps with the Pleasant Futures vision that the city has, I think you'll find there's widespread neighborhood and community support for it too. People are very enthusiastic about the potential for Pleasant Street, as the council president says, acting more as a gateway to the city. And I think, for example, it would allow us to add parking spaces if we wanted. And you know, as that crucial corridor grows and changes, so I'm very pleased that this is coming forward. And I think in that part of the city and in Ward 3, and actually anyone who cares about the health of downtown. I think should welcome this. I certainly do. So,
any other questions? No. I'd entertain a motion to approve this petition.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. The only other item is to inquire whether there's any new business. There being none, I'd entertain a motion to adjourn. So moved. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Back to you.
All right. Thank you. So now we come up to the consent agenda. Included in the consent agenda is the approval of the National Grid poll petition that you just had the hearing for. And also, you may have just heard the approval to the petition to discontinue the portion of Elm Street that will now be the site of the relocated gate to Smith College. Also, approve a petition to accept a portion of Pleasant Street, which we just discussed. The appointment of Linda Desmond as Director of Senior Services, and this is for a referral to the Committee on City Services. And then appointments to various committees, excuse me, also for referral to the Committee on City Services. We have Jean Page, this is for the Disability Commission. Jean Page, 46 Evergreen Road, 107 in Leeds. The term July 2016 to June 2019. Housing Partnership has Patrick Bowen, 95 Straw Avenue in Florence, a term to start July 2016 and expires June 2019. Mark Goggins of 27 Spruce Lane in Florence, term to start August 2016, expire June 2019. The Human Rights Commission, Brian Barnes of 269 Main Street, number 2A in Northampton, the term to start July 2016, expire June 2019. Tara Gangli, I hope I pronounced that correctly, 55A Chestnut Street in Florence. The term starts July 2016, expires June 2019. And Christine Young of 1443 West Hampton Road in Florence, and the term also starting July 2016, expiring June 2019. And for License Commission, it's a reappointment for William Rosen of 2 Laurel Lane in Northampton, the term to start July 2016, expire June 2019. Parks and Recreation Commission, David Cronin of 103 Pioneer Knolls Extension in Florence, the term starts July 2016, expires June 2019. This is a reappointment. And then also to reappoint Thomas Dumphy of 6 Chesterfield Road in Leeds, again, the term July 2016 to June 2019. Then Elizabeth Silver for the Zoning Board of Appeals, 67 Willow Street in Florence, the term July 2016 to June 2019. And this is moving from associate member to full member. And then to approve the minutes of the City Council meeting of June 23rd, 2016. And then also to approve the minutes of the City Council meeting of June 28th, 2016. I'll accept a motion on the consent agenda.
Second.
Okay.
All those in favor of moving the consent agenda forward, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, time for another recess. Now we go to the Finance Committee, where Council Murphy takes the floor.
Thank you. I'll call this to order and ask Pam to please read the roll of vice.
Council Murphy?
Here.
Council Carney?
Present.
Council LeBarge?
Present.
And our first item is approve the minutes of the June 23rd meeting. Do we have a motion?
Move to approve.
You have a second?
Thanks, Ed.
You have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Excellent. Okay. We have a number of financial orders. The first one is 16125, an order to appropriate capital projects from the general fund FY17 cash capital account. Order that the following capital projects be appropriated from the general fund FY17 cash capital account. Central Services Fire Department, update the alarm system, $16,598. Central Services Fire Department, security access system, $50,000. Information technology, replacement of equipment for $50,000. Information technology, multi-facility energy management system, $18,020. Information technology, laser fiche document management update, $33,500. Dispatch, radio study, $25,000. The police department firing range, $51,882. And DPW mezzanine storage for $35,000. The total would be $280,000. And these were all items that were included in the capital plan that we approved with the budget. Do we have a motion put on the floor?
Make a motion.
Second.
Okay. And the mayor's here to discuss.
You are correct, Councilor. Because these are cash capital, that means they're going to be coming from the cash capital account of the FY17 budget, which is why we could not bring them forward until after July when we have an FY17 budget. So these were part of the capital improvement program, part of the proposed capital budget, but they were not in the we had to wait until we had the cash capital account populated to bring these forward. So they're smaller size projects that we typically would not bond for, which is why we pay for them out of cash capital. So.
Mm-hmm. Any questions for the mayor, from anyone?
Just about the radio study for the dispatch. That is to, now I understand that their equipment has certainly become outdated and ready to be re-upped. Is this to basically survey that equipment? And
actually, we're already replacing the dispatcher consoles and upgrading those. That was a separate capital project. This is a little bit deceiving because dispatch is the department and then radio study is the actual project. So dispatch is leading this. This is actually a citywide radio study, and it's actually an effort to take a look at all of our various radios that are, you know, fire, DPW, police, which back in the day when they were created, they were all kind of siloed and created separately. So what we're trying to do is, as we now are getting close to upgrading our technology, basically bringing in a communications experts to look at, are there ways we can combine towers, are there ways that we can, and also buy radios that are all compatible on the same frequency so that we have good cross communication. So this is a comprehensive study of all of our radio systems, including, you know, again, police, fire, DPW, which has their own dispatching for plows and things like that, as well as any of the other handhelds, central services, the schools, et cetera. So that's what this radio study is about. We've had a working group of all of these different folks that have been looking at this. This is kind of the culmination of trying to figure out so that just not one department's going to move forward and buy a certain radio that might be on a certain frequency and then they would not be compatible with others, which is the case in some cases now.
So the objective is to create universality in the system.
Exactly, as well as potential savings and actually maybe better coverage by utilizing antenna assets and placing assets better throughout the city. So.
Yeah, capital improvements for a long time has seen requests from various departments for updating their radios because they're required to do frequency shifts. And capital improvements has always insisted that you guys got to get together and do this in a uniform manner so that everybody uses similar towers and similar equipment and that the stuff is interchangeable so that we get
you know, all the departments able to communicate with each other and nobody's doing it as an isolated project. And, you know, it's been going on a long time and it's nice to see it coming to fruition finally, so that when everybody does their frequency changes, they'll all be together. And it will just increase communication between the various departments that have to do emergency things in coordination. So it's a good thing. Any other questions for the mayor on any of these? So all in favor of a positive recommendation in finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Thank you. The next is another order to transfer funds into the compensated absence reserve fund. Order that the amount of $11,551.37 be transferred from the FY16 unused earned leave account to the compensated absences reserve for the future payment of accrued liabilities of compensated absences due to any employee or full-time officer of the city upon the termination of the employee or full-time officer's employment. Do we have a motion on this one?
Quite a motion.
Second.
Okay. And any of you want to speak to this one? This is just shifting the money from one year to another, correct?
Yeah, this was actually a DOR recommendation that we implemented, I think, a fiscal year ago, which basically creates, I don't want to call it a stabilization account because it's not, but it basically, when we budget for the unused earned leave account, if there's any tailings at the end of the year that don't get spent, and in this case, it's this $11,000 that they recommend putting it into this unused earned leave account, or it's actually called the compensated, so transferring from that into the compensated absences reserve fund. So it's basically a reserve fund. And this was something, do we set it up in 15 or
16?
2 years ago, yeah. So this is the second or third year we've come forward to you at the end of the year if there's been any balance that we've put into this account. And again, this is, again, just to have as a contingency if we do have someone that needs to be compensated that's not part of the regular budget. So
it's just basically shifting the unused money from 16 over so it can be used in 17.
That's
it. For the same purpose.
Yeah, and once it's in the reserve fund, it is like a stabilization fund, mm-hmm. So it does not have to be reappropriated. It just remains in the account.
It's available for the new fiscal year.
Yep.
Any other questions for the mayor on this one? Okay, all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The next one is 16-128, in order to authorize intermunicipal agreements for FY17. Order that whereas Mass General Law Section 40, Subsection 4A allows for joint operation of public activities among governmental units, and whereas Mass General Law Chapter 40, Section 4A requires that such intergovernmental agreements be approved in a city by the council and the mayor, and whereas the City of Northampton provides services to and shares services with other municipalities, therefore, pursuant to Mass General Law Section 40, Subsection 4A, the City Council hereby authorizes the City of Northampton to enter into the following intermunicipal agreements for fiscal year 2017. Contract with the Town of Williamsburg for building inspection and zoning enforcement services. Agreement to provide the Town of Williamsburg with services for a lump sum per the agreement. Contract with the Town of Williamsburg for electrical inspection services. Agreement to provide the Town of Williamsburg with services with fees for permits turned over to the City of Northampton. Contract with the Town of Amherst, Hadley, East Hampton for municipal hearing officer services. Agreement to provide municipal hearing officer service pursuant to Mass General Law Section 148A, Subsection 2C, to hear complaints related to alleged violations of state building codes or state fire codes for lump sum per the agreement. Contract with the Town of Amherst, Cummington, Hadley, Middlefield, Pelham, Williamsburg, Goshen, and Worthington to provide veterans officer services agreements to provide for these services to the various communities with an assessment to individual towns per the agreement. Contract with the Town of Granby, Hadley, and Amherst to provide sealer of weights and measures services agreement to provide these services to the various communities and assessments to the individual towns as per those agreements. Contract with the Franklin County of Regional Governments to monitor and support the Greater Franklin County Economic Target Area. Contracts with the Town of Amherst for kennel services. Town of Amherst to provide kennel space for dogs in the custody of the Northampton Animal Control Officer per that agreement. Pioneer Valley Bike Share Partnership with the cities of Holyoke and Springfield, Town of Amherst, UMass, and the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission for the purposes of establishing, managing, and operating regional bike share systems for the Pioneer Valley, and a contract with the Franklin Regional Council of Governments to partner with the City of Northampton through its Health Department relative to the following contracts. One, provide services relative to the Hampshire Medical Reserve Corps, and two, to provide emergency management services for the Hampshire Public Health Emergency Preparedness Coalition. Do we have a motion on this one?
Motion.
Second.
Second. All right. And the mayor can comment on this one.
Well, just, you know, when you hear people talk about, you know, regionalization, these are examples of where Northampton has partnered with surrounding communities to regionalize various services. These are all existing services, and every year under Mass General Law, we're required to renew these intermunicipal agreements. Mm-hmm. And so not only are you voting on this, but the select board in these towns have all had to take votes on it as well. So we have to go ahead and do this every
year. And are there any new ones in here? These are all ongoing, aren't they?
Yes.
There were new ones?
These are all ongoing.
Ongoing.
Yeah.
Okay. Councilor?
Pioneer Valley Bike Share, I remember that being discussed and being considered,
yeah.
And
yep.
I haven't seen a bike yet.
Well, it's a longer term planning process. We have been working collaboratively with the four communities that are involved, and have applied for funding, CMAC funding, which is congestion mitigation funding, through the Regional Transportation Improvement Program, or TIP. And so we're in the queue to receive some additional monies. We got some monies to begin the planning process. PVPC is kind of the lead on it, and have allocated planning resources. And each of the four communities have been participating in planning meetings. And so we're hoping that we'll move the idea forward. It's going to be a little bit of a slower process, but yeah.
I was going to say, I mean, I remember talking about this like 6 years ago.
Yeah, this isn't quite that old. Okay. I mean, bike sharing has been talked about in Northampton in various iterations. We did investigate initially, looking whether Northampton could do something on its own, and you know, in terms of the way these systems work and the expense and the capital investment and the maintenance costs. Does sort of require a little bit of an economy of scale, so that's the advantage of trying to partner with four other interested communities, so that we could potentially, you know, jointly purchase that infrastructure and share in the joint maintenance costs, et cetera. Obviously, having systems deployed in each of our communities, but so that's the concept, and so this one's about a year and a half. Or so, I think a year and a half to 2 years. That we've been working with PVPC on this. So, so that's where we are.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for the mayor, councilor?
The degree of regionalization is in fact impressive. There's more going on than I'd realized.
Yeah.
Just curious, what else? What are the next targets of opportunity for regional sharing of expertise and resources?
You know, we're always. Conversations with with different communities. A couple of years ago, we applied for a grant with the city of East Hampton, or I guess the town of East Hampton that is a city, we did a study looking at the potentials for regional emergency dispatch, for example. At the time, there wasn't the funding was not the model didn't really work for the communities. We are also, I know that our many of our departments, like our health department, you see a couple of examples of the health department working in a regional capacity. One of the things we've talked about as well on the health side is trying to form a mosquito control district, a regional district, which is more common in the eastern part of the state, which is a way to, you may know that this year the city has contracted with a private contractor to do mosquito monitoring and testing, and to do analysis of the city, and to work on mitigation efforts. In some parts of the state, you know, particularly in southeastern Massachusetts, there are these regional mosquito-controlled districts that are eligible for funding from the state and again, can do some of these things through an economy of scale. So we've had conversations among various communities and the health departments in those communities, but they're still just sort of in the conversation stages. So we are always looking for opportunities to look for ways to expand our services. You know, veteran services started out with a few communities. It has continued to expand communities. Hadley and what's the other one that we added? I know Hadley and there's one other that's in. Chester, like Hadley and Chester just were added a couple years ago. So we've slowly added ones. Did you have another one?
No, I was just thinking there's two programs. Progressed into us hiring our full.
Yeah. So that's a case where it's not regional, but yeah.
But it started as regional.
That's true. We have had some shared services that for whatever reason we've been able to use it to build capacity. There's one that just popped into my head. Our IT director is on a regional IT committee of regional communities, of IT directors around the region. And there's been discussions among those different communities about potential for sharing of resources. And so there's potential in that realm as well. Because many of the services and many of the software and many of the other things that we deploy are similar, so there's potential for sharing resources there. So particularly when you have a situation where you have a small, like in our situation where we have many small towns around us, there's options to be able to host software for smaller communities. So we are actively exploring those as well. So
that's fine.
Question, and this is probably more appropriate for the budget hearings that we had, but most of these are services that we're regionalizing. What about procurement of particular products and things that could be purchased in larger kind of bulk?
Yep.
Has that been explored?
We do participate in some regional procurement, particularly through the schools. There's a regional, there's a Hampshire COG procurement program that we purchase through, and the state. We obviously go through some of the state. They do procurement and bidding for cities and towns, and then we're able to just purchase from that using that economy of scale. We have looked from time to time at energy, but what we found is that we generally are able to get more competitive bids just as the city of Northampton. There are some regional energy purchasing. Hampshire Power, for example, is a Hampshire COG program where they do regional purchasing for smaller cities and towns. We've looked at that, but we actually are able, just because of the size of the city and the amount of energy, electricity that we're buying, have not found it to be advantageous, so we continue to do that. But we're consistent. We look at those offer. We look at those. We speak with folks about that. So those are some of the things that we look at as well. Yeah. And we for example, purchasing of it's a little bit nuanced, but there are regional planning authorities throughout the state that do. That do regional bid processes, like for police cruisers or for fire trucks or for things like that, which if we join those, and usually it's a very nominal fee to join them, it allows us to purchase from those particular things. What's this?
Antonio did. He saved us $12,000.
What's that? Oh, yeah. This is just an example of she was just reminding me that we had, we had an opportunity to bid on some equipment, and we bought it off a state contract.
We actually bid.
Yeah. So we examine. We're always looking at whether bidding regionally or bidding, or just bidding ourselves makes the most sense in terms of procurement. Yeah.
Well, perhaps the shared bikes could come equipped with fly swatters, so the riders could kill mosquitoes.
That would be helpful.
So, in the committee, to the intermunicipal agreements, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. All right, the next one is 16129, in order to reprogram remaining funds from an FY15 capital project to the Fire Rescue Department Security Access System. Order that $7,000 of the remaining balance of the FY15 capital project plan for the JFK Pool Dehumidification Replacement System be reprogrammed to provide additional funds for the Fire Rescue Department Security Access System due to bids coming in higher than originally estimated for the fire rescue project. Do we have a motion?
Make a motion.
Second.
Any questions of the mayor, the finance director on this one? The DEPCON system has been on the capital improvements budget for a while, and there was a little money left over, so they're just trying to use it for another capital improvement project.
Yeah, and this is just a case of where we had it on the capital plan, but then we actually did the bids, and the bids came in, $7,000 above what we had estimated.
And the dehumidifier was less than expected.
Exactly.
So we have a little money left.
Exactly. So we're just reprogramming funds from one project to another.
Any questions on this one? Okay. Then all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The next one is 16130. In order to raise and appropriate funds for Northampton Public Schools and the Smith Vocational High School, order that the city will raise and appropriate for fiscal year 2017 the following amounts relative to the additional Chapter 70 funds the city will receive from the Commonwealth. The Northampton Public Schools will receive $95,970, and Smith Vocational and Agricultural School will receive $3,605. Provided that the appropriation for Smith Vocational and Agricultural School shall be used solely for the purposes of meeting net school spending as defined by the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, and no funds so appropriate shall be transferred to any account or expended for any purpose that would not be included in the calculation of net school spending. Do we have a motion on this one?
Make a motion.
Second.
Okay, and the mayor can explain this one.
Yes, so when we built our fiscal year 2017 budget, and submitted it to you. We built it initially using the governor's proposed budget, which had projected actually a slight decrease in Chapter 70, but basically a $20 per child increase in Chapter 70. The House budget was actually not even scheduled to be introduced, I think, until the day that I had to submit my budget, or a couple of days before. And there were rumors that they were going to increase Chapter 70, but we weren't sure how much that would be. The House did end up increasing Chapter 70 to $55 per child, which was great and wonderful, and we appreciate that increase. The Senate maintain that increase to $55, and of course there were some cuts made to other education programs, but suffice it to say I had made the commitment to the two school districts that if in fact Chapter 70 did come in at a higher number in the final state budget, that I would appropriate that additional. I'm not required to, but I made the pledge that I would appropriate the additional Chapter 70 monies to each of the districts. So this is an additional $95,970 to NPS, and then $3,605. So it's basically, the difference, the $35 additional per child that's being appropriated. Interestingly, you could rejoice and say, NPS is getting another $95,000, but of course, one of the ways that they achieved increasing Chapter 70 was to eliminate what are called kindergarten incentive grants, which were grants that were set up several years ago to try to incentivize people to go to full day kindergarten. So, they giveth and taketh away. So yes, there's a $95,000 increase. I don't know what the decrease will be on the kindergarten grant, but it's in the neighborhood of about $72,000, that grant annually to NPS, which I do not know. I don't know that that was among the governor's vetoes. Anyway, that's the reason why I'm coming back to you now in July to appropriate this additional money into the budget, and specifically to the school districts for the increase in Chapter 70.
Questions for the mayor?
The stipulation about it being applied to net school spending, is that Is that language that's boilerplate, or is that something?
That's actually language that if you look at your budget, your regular appropriation order, that's language that we've included in our appropriations to Smith Vocational as part of my agreeing to meet net school spending under protest with DESE, because it's a really strange, Smith Voc is like no other district, and there are issues with net school spending, but I've agreed to meet it. But one of the stipulations, and DESE has supports this, is that basically this requires them to spend all of this money on net school spending eligible items only, because depending on how they allocate other funds, we could, and this has actually happened, I've come to you and requested a transfer to, that's what actually precipitated, I requested a transfer to meet net school spending, and then they didn't spend it all on net school spending items, and so we didn't meet net school spending. So this is just, because we're the only district that has to meet, we're a small part of their budget that's dependent on net school spending, this is just language that DESE recommended that we include in all of our appropriations. I know that's a long and wonky answer, but that's why we have that language for Smith Vocational.
It struck me, and I thought as much, but...
But it is, if you look in the main appropriation orders in the FY17 budget, the language is in there as well, so.
Mm-hmm. Trust me. Any other questions on this one? All in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The next is 16-132, in order to provide for FY2016 end-of-the-year budget transfers. Ordered the following FY16 budgetary transfers be and hereby made. Reserve for personnel, wage adjustment and reclassification, $250. Legal services, they don't get any. Central services, streetlights and signals, $28,523, and interest on long-term debt, $28,733, which is the total. That's where the money comes from, and it's going to reserve for personnel, and it's going to central services. So the total amount of money transferring is $28,773, and it's going from long-term interest debt to reserve for personnel and for central services streetlights. Motion?
Make a motion.
Second.
Yeah, so the legal services is it's superfluous. It doesn't need to be on there. I think
Leftover from prior transfer.
And in the past, we have sometimes had to come back at the end of the year for legal services. We have not had to this year. So as you'll see, the bulk of this funding is basically going to cover the central services street signal lights account. Streetlights are the topic tonight, and in fact, we had projected when we built this budget savings from the streetlight project that we thought would have been underway and up and installed at this point. Obviously, we've delayed the project because we want to seek more public input, and now we've had a second round of public input. So, some of our savings estimates that we were looking at, when we built this budget, based on the installation of LED lights, did not happen. So we're just transferring some additional money into that line item.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions on the counselor?
I was just curious that the funds are coming from interest on long-term debt. I would have imagined that was a pretty fixed.
Well, that's actually, you may recall that we did the reissuance of bonds this year.
Ah.
Which is where we save significantly on our long-term debt interest. So that's how we created that savings. When we did the bond reissuance, again, we did have a fairly set amount that was in that fund, but when we did the bond reissuance, it lowered our long-term interest debt. So
good thing.
It all kind of is connected.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Any other questions on this one? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation, finance,
aye.
Say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. All right, the next one is 16-133, in order to accept a 1953 Jeep on behalf of the family, donated on behalf of the family of Jack Joyce. Order that whereas Jack Joyce was a lifelong resident of the city and a local businessman, and whereas the family of Jack Joyce wishes to honor his memory with the gift of his 1953 Korean War era Jeep and trailer, and whereas the Jeep is being donated to the City of Northampton Veterans Services Department for use of the department and the Veterans Council of Northampton and Central Hampshire Veterans District for use during parades and ceremonies, and whereas the family stipulates that the Jeep shall not become an asset of any other city department nor be sold without express written consent of the Veterans Council of Northampton, and the lettering will be added to the Jeep, we'll say XO of the 319th Field Hospital. Order that in accordance with the Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 44, Section 53A½, the City of Northampton gratefully accepts the donation of a 1953 Jeep and trailer on behalf of the city from the family of Jack Joyce, which will be in the care and custody and control of the Northampton Veterans Services, subject to the following conditions. The Jeep and trailer shall not be transferred to the care and custody or control of any other city department or individual without written consent of the Veterans Council of Northampton, and that the Jeep and trailer shall not be sold as an asset of the City of Northampton without the written consent of the Veterans Council of Northampton, and that the following lettering be added to the Jeep, XO of the 309th Field Hospital. We have a motion to accept.
Second.
Okay. Any comment on this one?
I think this order is fairly self-explanatory. When this gift was made, initially they were trying to think of a way that the Veterans Council could potentially accept it, but of course the Veterans Council is not really an entity. It's sort of a collaborative of a bunch of different, VFW, World War II club, and it just made sense in terms of who could, register and sort of be the constant that would have the vehicle, that it made sense for our Veterans Services Department to do it. It's actually being restored now through donations and some of the members. I'll let you guess who might be involved in that.
Both certain auto body shop operators.
Exactly. And most likely it'll be, garage at one of those places. Again, the idea is that we want to have a way to accept this gift, and it'll only be used for the various parades, Memorial Day, Veterans Day, mm-hmm. and other ceremonial. So obviously we're very thankful to the Joyce family for doing this.
Mm-hmm. Counselor.
So that vehicle is probably, what, about 60-something years old? What is the value of that?
I do not know. I know that it needed some body work, and I know it needed some mechanical work to get it up to speed, and obviously some painting. I don't know if a value was put on it. Because it's real property, we do need a vote of the council and the approval of the council and the mayor to accept it. I don't have a value on it, so I don't know if it's been appraised. It's sort of, think MASH. If you watch MASH, this is sort of a, Korean War era Jeep.
The Willys,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions on the counselor?
I was the proud owner of a 1966 Willys Jeep at one point, and I would imagine there's tremendous sentimental value, and I don't imagine an appraisal would show mm-hmm. a huge amount. But but it's a wonderful gift.
I think for it coming to you in a parade soon, maybe even by Veterans Day, we'll see.
And a lot of people have seen the one that Look Park has.
Exactly.
Park has an antique.
Yes, they do.
That Christensen drove around for years and years and years. So that's kind of what we're talking about.
Exactly.
You've seen around Look Park.
Yeah.
And they've taken very good care of that one. That's been all restored.
Yep.
All right. Then in finance, all in favor of accepting the gift of the Jeep, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right. All right. And finally, 16-134, an order for a home rule petition to authorize the mayor to seek special legislation to amend the acts of 1994, Chapter 86. And when this comes up in council, two readings are requested. Order that whereas the City of Northampton supports the development of affordable housing, whereas pursuant to Chapter 86 of the Acts of 1994, the state legislature authorizes the conveyance of certain lots on Laurel Street and Burt's Pit Road to the Northampton Housing Authority for the construction of affordable housing, and whereas Chapter 86 also authorizes the conveyance of certain parcels on Grove Street for use as an emergency homeless shelter, And whereas the 1999, the Commonwealth acting through its Division of Capital Asset Management and Maintenance conveyed the Laurel Street and Burt's Pit Road parcels to the City of Northampton Housing Authority with a requirement that the parcels be used for affordable housing within 5 years of the conveyance, or the parcels would revert to the Commonwealth. And whereas in 1998, the Commonwealth acting through its Division of Capital Asset Management and Maintenance conveyed the Grove Street parcel to the City of Northampton, which parcel is currently used as an emergency shelter known as the Grove Street Inn and operated under a lease by ServiceNet. And whereas the Northampton Housing Authority has not constructed affordable housing on the Laurel Street and Burt's Pit Road parcels, and whereas in order to effectuate the construction of affordable housing on the Laurel Street and Burt's Pit Road parcels, the city would like an amendment to Chapter 86 authorizing the Division of Capital Asset Management and Maintenance to convey the Laurel Street and Burt's Pit Road parcels to the city for reconveyance to a developer for the affordable housing. And whereas the mayor would like to an authorization to convey the Grove Street parcel to the operator of the emergency shelter with the provision for the revision to the city should the operator cease to operate an emergency shelter, and whereas special legislation is required in order to obtain the necessary amendments to Chapter 86, and in order for the state legislature to consider such special legislation, a vote of the council authorizing such legislation is required, and whereas the City of Northampton Housing Authority supports the proposed amendment to Chapter 86, and on July 18, 2016, the board is expected to take a vote in support of the proposed legislation. Now, therefore, it be ordered that the mayor is authorized and directed to seek special legislation to amend the Acts of 1994, Chapter 86, in substantially the form set forth in the proposed legislation entitled An Act Relating to Land in Northampton, which is attached hereto and incorporated for the reference, fully set forth herein, that the mayor be authorized to make amendments to the proposed legislation attached hereto in his sole discretion in order to effectuate the purpose of this order. Do we have a motion?
Make a motion.
Second. And now the mayor can explain all of that.
Yes, and I have to first explain the reason, the timeliness issue, because this is an issue that we've been working on with Representative Cocott for many months, and through special legislation. And I, as Pam can attest, Tuesday at about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, which of course is almost 3 hours shy of the deadline for posting tonight's meeting, I got an email from Representative Cocott saying, House Council had looked at it and DCAM Council had looked at it, and we need to have the council take a vote on this, and have the solicitor draft something and get it back to House Council. So within about 3 hours, we had to draft this, send it to House Council for edits, and then get it to Pam so that we could try to get this on the agenda. So I apologize that we're coming to you sort of in the 11th hour. Of course, the reason for two readings is that the legislature only has about two more weeks of a formal session. Representative Cocott is trying to get this completed finally. So the quick story is, of course, when the Northampton State Hospital was closed, Chapter 86 of the Acts of 1994 was adopted, which was the disposition of all the various lands. Lands were given out to various organizations, including the city. Obviously, the Village Hill parcel was set aside for redevelopment, Recreation Department, the ag lands that Smith Vogt controls. Don't call it a dog park. There were two parcels that were, as you read in the language, were given to the Northampton Housing Authority for development as affordable housing. And then there was the Grove Street shelter was conveyed to the city, and it was our obligation to run it as a homeless shelter forever. So on the latter issue, what we really want to do is to have the flexibility to work with the operator, and I've had conversations with ServiceNet, to have the option, because right now we lease it to them on a long-term lease, and that arrangement works well, although it does not give ServiceNet the flexibility that they'd like. to be able to apply for grants, to be able to do work on the property and through donations and things like that. And frankly, it is a little bit odd that Central Services is in charge of that building that's pretty much 24/7 run by another organization. And so so this is something that actually ServiceNet supports. There is a model for it. When we did the emergency cot shelter on Center Street, the city actually purchased, we allowed ServiceNet to purchase that using CDBG funds, but there is a reversion clause to the city if it ever stops being a 24-hour cot shelter. So so it's kind of modeled after that language. So this isn't really a major change because it has been a emergency homeless shelter since the legislation was passed. It will continue to be an emergency homeless shelter. This is just more giving us some added flexibility of whether we want to do it through lease or actually allowing us to convey it to them directly. So that's number one. Number two is the two parcels, one on Laurel Street and one on Burt's Pit Road. Until about a year ago, if you went on Laurel Street, you could see the old building that was there. It had kind of like, you know, boarded up and had X's, and mostly it was a home for raccoons. It was in a bit of an eyesore. We did actually use some CDBG blight dollars to actually take it down, but it's been clear over time that the Housing Authority, well, obviously they didn't meet the five-year requirement of developing it. So it's sort of been in this odd limbo of two parcels being there, not being developed. So what we've proposed is that the city, that they be sort of reconveyed to the city so that we could try to work with groups like Habitat or Valley CDC to get them developed and get them being used for affordable housing. You'll see that there's an email that I gave you that I passed out tonight. This is something that we've talked to the Housing Authority about. The Housing Authority is supportive of this. The director is supportive. They had a long discussion about it. They didn't take a vote because they weren't prepared to take a vote at their last meeting. But on Monday, they'll be voting on the motion that you have, which again is just basically to signal that they support Representative Cocott's legislation and they support the reconveyance of the properties to the city of Northampton. So that's what this is all about. It's going back, sort of going back in the time machine to 1994 and making some changes to that original legislation so that it'll fit with sort of our modern day needs.
Does the Housing Authority have a reason for why they didn't fulfill their commitment?
Funding primarily. They did, on the Burt's Pit parcel, they did engage in a planning and design process, and they actually worked with, I think it was still called, maybe called DMR at the time. The acronyms have all changed, but they had looked at developing a kind of a congregate housing for severely disabled folks and with services. The problem is that the design was done, but there was never capital funding allocated to the project. They're a state agency. They're dependent on state funds to do capital projects like that. One project that they did do before, and I'm not sure why or when the funding dried up, but some of you may know the McColgan House on Grove Street, which is right where the T of the Laurel Street and Grove Street is. That happened early in my first term as Ward 4 City Councilor. They that was a parcel of state hospital land that they did redevelop and built housing, and so that was one of the projects of several projects. But these two projects, the funding, the capital funding from DHCD was just never available for it, and you know, we know the struggles that Housing Authority faces in terms of just trying to maintain its current properties. So I think that they're very realistic that this is not something that they see that they would be able to do. In addition to the fact that, you know, the 5 years lapsed several years ago, so at least by the letter of the law. So we would need to have some kind of a legislative correction. So Peg Keller has met with them and talked with them, and so we just think this will be a better way for us to get these properties doing what the legislature had intended, so.
Other questions, counselor? Counselors?
Well, I'd just say, first of all, I think this is great, and thanks to you and Representative Cocott and Peg Keller for working on this, because it's hard to find opportunities for affordable housing.
So these are
some good ones. So that's excellent. I was just curious, I guess the vote by the Housing Authority was more sort of an informal courtesy, really, because they don't really have any control over it at this point, do they?
You're correct. Yeah, okay. Technically, although oddly, the DCAM did, right now, there's a, if you go to look at the Registry of Deeds, it was conveyed by DCAM to the Housing Authority. Mm-hmm. So it will require a reconveyance. And I think the legislature, DCAM, just wanted to know whether this was going to be a friendly proposition or just. So I think we were trying to get them as much assurance as possible. You may be familiar in your ward, there's another project. It doesn't require a special act, but there's a parcel of land that used to be farmland for the old jail, and that we're trying to get released as part of a separate special act that we filed. And the jail hasn't been on Union Street for years, and that land hasn't been in farming by the jail in decades. And so, but they still wanted a letter from the Hampshire County Jail that they didn't want this property anymore. So I think it's just sort of a legislative sort of CYA, as they call it, just to make
formality.
Sure. Formality. What's that?
Formality.
Formality.
Southside.
Okay.
Southside.
And just as a follow-up, an unrelated follow-up, once we can convey these, the city, if it chose, we could put certain conditions on them to a certain extent if we wanted to encourage certain kinds of development for affordable housing, for example, or...
Yeah, I think we could. It does provide a little bit more flexibility. And that was actually something that the Housing Authority had even looked at themselves, because they had even thought at one point about trying to get the legislation changed so that they could have a little more flexibility themselves to the kind of housing. I mean, right now, if you go there, there have been 4 single-family homes built in a row. And so, there's already sort of a new neighborhood that has built up on that side of Laurel Street. What may have been envisioned for a Housing Authority type property may not fit in the character of the neighborhood now.
Right.
So, yeah.
And the Housing Authority wouldn't be eligible for, say, Community Preservation Act funding that might facilitate
exactly
in the future, but the city would.
Exactly.
So that
the city would
actually is financially a wise move as well.
Exactly.
We didn't have to do this. Okay.
Exactly. Yeah. And it does. I think I don't see the latest. I have to look at it. But yeah, our ability to convey it, and we would, we would work on, developing an RFP of some kind and set guidance. Yeah.
I think it's great.
Yeah.
I too am pleased that 2 really good parcels for housing are being potentially freed up to be finally used. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned RFP, so I assume that would be the process. And you have any idea of a timetable for?
We're not sure. We're going to have to. We're going to have to work on putting something together. It may just be that we are. Seeking a developer, putting out an RFP to seek a master developer of some kind or something along those lines. We'll have to look at what, we do have some, we have done some of these kinds of projects, though usually you may remember the Garfield Terrace Habitat project, and there was one city parcel that remained that we actually did the tiny lot competition, and then eventually RFP'd the land and sold it. So I'm not saying that's what we're going to do here. I'm just saying that we do have some experience at that. We also have a lot of experienced affordable housing developers in the city, obviously, between Valley and Hap and Habitat for Humanity.
There's
a lot of experienced developers that we could turn to.
Well, and as that process unfolds,
yep,
some involvement of that immediate neighborhood would
Oh, no doubt about it.
It'd be really important, and I'd be...
Yep.
I think in the way the line's been redrawn, that's no Ward 2. I'd be...
Yes.
Be glad to...
Most definitely.
Help with that process.
Yep, most definitely, yeah. And I know the neighbors are glad that the, that at least on Laurel Street, I know they're glad the building is gone. Because it was a...
Indeed.
It was an eyesore, and it was a wildlife home. Home for wandering wildlife.
Home for aged raccoons.
So I know that they're glad. And obviously, a fire trap and, you know, any of the other concerns that they have, so...
Any other questions on this at this point? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation in Finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And I know of...
Just again, my reason for the two readings is because by the time you get to August, the legislature will be out of session, and then we'll have to...
This is like their last-minute grant they gave us. We have to do...
Exactly, yeah. So that's...
We got mystery money.
Yes.
Okay. So I don't know of any new business, so in order, motion to adjourn.
Counselor.
Someone?
We have, no.
We have new business?
All these financial orders are two readings tonight.
Just the last one?
No, all of them.
Oh, all of them, two readings.
It's on the regular agenda.
Yeah.
It's on, not in the Finance, but the regular agenda.
We can get to that as we...
Yeah.
We can explain that.
Okay. But not relevant to us, because we don't do two readings. So was that a motion to adjourn? Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, we go back into regular session. And now, relative to Counsel LaBarge's remark, the next items are the financial orders you just reviewed and a request for two readings on all of them. And as I know most of you can imagine, what the reason for that is, again, as I said, we're on our foreshortened schedule for the summer, and it would mean months before actually you realize there's... And Mayor wants to expand on that.
No, the only other reason is that some of these are transfers that are being made within the now-closed FY16 budget. And we are allowed until July 15th to make final...
That's tomorrow, isn't it?
Yep.
Yes, final adjustments in the, to the FY16 budget, to move money within the FY16 budget before it closes out. We don't have access to free cash anymore after June 30th, but this is a way of doing sort of final chewing up of the budget. That's why we typically ask you to hold this meeting sometime on or before July 15th, because of this very reason. So that's why we need two readings tonight, because the readings would have to be taken before July 15th. So...
Okay.
In addition to the other issue about the, in some cases, for some of the projects that we're trying to get out to bid, not wanting to wait until the end of August.
Right.
Your second meeting. In some cases, we're seeking two readings just so that we can get the bidding process underway.
And I should point out that this is actually fairly commonplace for the council to be doing on their July meeting, is doing the scramble with two readings. So, but we'll address that on each item as it comes up. So first item, of course, is 16.125. That's the financial order to appropriate capital projects from the general fund FY17 cash capital account. Is there a motion?
Move to approve.
Second? Somewhere? Yeah? Okay. You got it? Okay. Discussion. Roll call, please.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Suspend rule.
That passes in first reading. There's been a motion to suspend rules to allow for a second reading. Is there a second? There's a second. All those in favor of suspending rules, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I'll accept a motion to put on the floor.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes. That passes in second reading. Next item is 16.126, the financial order to transfer funds into the compensated absences reserve fund.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Suspend.
That passes in first reading. There's been a motion to suspend rules.
Second.
A second.
Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I'll accept a motion.
So moved.
Okay. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
That passes in second reading. Item 16.128 of the financial order to authorize the intermunicipal agreements for FY 2017.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. There's a motion to suspend.
Second.
Second. Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? I'll accept a motion.
Move approved.
Motion's made, seconded for, is there any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Next item is 16.129. It's the financial order to reprogram the remaining funds from an FY 15 capital project to the Fire Rescue Department Security Access System.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Passes in first reading. There's been a motion to suspend rules.
Second.
Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any accept a motion and put this on?
To approve.
Second.
Made, seconded. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Now we're at item 16.130, financial order to appropriate funds from the Northampton Public Schools and Smith Vocational and Agricultural High School.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
That passes in first reading.
Suspend rule 14.
There's been a motion made to suspend rules and seconded. All those in favor of suspending rules, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay, accept a motion.
Move approval.
Second it.
Motion's made and seconded to move this forward. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes. Excuse me. Next up is item 16.132, financial order to provide for the FY 2016 end of the year budget transfers.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion on the motion? Roll call, please.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
That passes in first reading.
Suspend rules.
Motion's been made and seconded to suspend rules. Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions?
Move to approve.
To approve.
Motion's made and seconded to put it on the floor. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
That item passes in second reading. Item 16.133 is financial order for the City Council to accept a gift of a 1953 Jeep on behalf of the city from the family of Jack Joyce.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this? I'd just like to say thank you to the Joyce family. I think that this is a great way to commemorate this very good man. Okay, no further discussion. Roll call, please.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
That passes in first reading.
Suspend the rule.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded to suspend rules. Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Move to approve.
Motion's made. Second. We're on the floor and seconded.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor Labarge? Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Now we're on to orders. This is 16.112, administrative order to amend the City of Northampton's administrative code. This requires only one vote, so there's no request for two readings. I'll accept a motion to put it on the floor.
Second.
Motion's made in second. Discussion on this. We had this in the public hearing, as you can see. Counselor O'Donnell?
I completely understand the logic behind this change in the administrative code. I think it's an example of us trying to find our feet as a city after the charter has changed. And because of all the changes that have occurred, this makes sense to me. The thing I'd be most interested in discussing either tonight or going forward would be the council's role and possibly fulfilling the role that the Public Works Commission did play in involving citizens in major decisions on public works. I know others in the council have had these discussions or have had thoughts about how we might do that through our new committee system that we established after changing our rules last year. So just to make that point, I think that that's a very important thing that will be preserved, that's not being lost. And that's important for people who are seeing what we're doing tonight to realize is that public input and accountability are going to be still there in the process when we make major decisions and have conversations about public works issues.
Counselor Bidwell, do you want to characterize the conversation that?
I'd be glad to. I alluded to it earlier. We did have a good discussion in our committee, and we had former committee and council member Spector there to provide a little perspective, and the mayor joined us for the conversation, and I had also had a conversation that previous week with our DPW director. And the gist of the conversation was that indeed this is sort of the last committee standing in terms of where these issues can come for discussion and for public input. And so we agreed that we want to find a way for that form of robust discussion. And the DPW director agrees that this can become a forum for education and building support for the work of the department. So I think going forward, we'll find our way exactly what issues come before the committee and what's the nature of encouraging public involvement. We also discussed the fact that there's a lot of expertise and a lot of institutional memory out there in the form of previous members of the Board of Public Works. And we agreed that sort of on an ad hoc basis, as a function of the issues coming forward, we would want to invite those and others with expertise and background to serve in some sort of ad hoc capacity as needed, issue by issue. But I think we are agreed that this is a particularly important forum for those sort of discussions and public input going forward.
One of the concerns that was expressed, of course, was impaneling on a permanent level particular citizens and putting them in the same position that the current commission was experiencing, which is there might be items that have nothing to do with them, and having them come to a meetings over a period of a term, say, that it might be more appropriate to have the flexibility built in to identify experts in particular areas relative to the issues that we were discussing and invite them to participate and help instruct us, as opposed to, you know, as I said, impaneling them or making them indentured servants to boring meetings for a long time. So, and that gave, on some level, it satisfies some of the concerns that were expressed that even in public comment about. And as Councilor Bidwell pointed out, the last opportunity for the public to weigh in on issues that heretofore they've been doing through the Board of Public Works. Although I should say, I think with this is more flexibility because, first of all, there's an accountable agency, which is the council. We're elected, so we're responsible to the electorate. That was not the case of the Board of Public Works. They were all good people, but the fact is that they did not necessarily have to answer to the public, which is why, of course, we do set the water and sewer rates. And that it also gives them an opportunity to address us individually so that our decisions actually would take into consideration more often their viewpoints than previously would have been available. Plus, we also meet at a reasonable hour, which the Board of Public Works, I don't think it was done out of malevolence, but out of practicality, met at stupid o'clock in the morning. Not a lot of people could get to those meetings and felt somewhat closed out. So in search of trying to find a good, solid purpose for this committee, I think actually a public forum, an opportunity for education, opportunity to conduct hearings relative to rate setting and other issues, I think that hopefully will be able to serve even better and enhance the public's access and transparency to the whole process. So. All right. Any further discussion on the administrative order? As I said, this only requires one vote, so that we won't have another reading. So, and the motion has been, this has been put on the floor, right?
Yep.
Okay, I want to bypass that. Okay. Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Scherer?
Yes.
That does pass. Item 16.127, this is a warrant to provide for a special election on August 4th, 2016, for at-large city councilor. And of course, the request on this is for two readings for the reasons I stated before. So I'll accept the motion.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Councilor O'Donnell.
As I have in the past, I'm going to excuse myself and go examine the street lights outside or something while you debate this issue.
I don't think you'll get much time to do that, but hurry up.
All right.
Okay. So the motions are made and seconded. Any discussion on this item? Okay. So just to remind folks, this is an election. We had kind of a low turnout for the primary, which wasn't a surprise, an enormous surprise, but this one actually is seating the council. That was a primary election. This one's actually for the position. So that's August 4th.
Yes, I do have a question. I noticed one of the handouts was this
our city
clerk's summary of costs of the preliminary election. I imagine my colleagues are asked often about this and the cost of it. It's a topic of conversation. Do we anticipate that this next election would bear a similar cost? Do we?
Probably.
Well, as you can see, the way the items are laid out, yes, probably, because it's a citywide municipal right. election. This is so the cost that Councilor Bidwell is referring to for the primary election was $20,166.83, and it's very likely that the August 4th one would be as well. I was having a conversation with Fred Zimnock as he got here way too early, and we were talking about this, and this is a good and reasonable expense unless we're prepared to dispense with big chunks of the Constitution and how we govern ourselves, that this election is actually kind of critical. This is a necessary expense. It's not a frivolous expense. This isn't one that I don't think we ever have to apologize for. I think it is a necessary expense. And as such, with that investment, I hope that the community, basically this last election, the primary election, comes out to about $1 per person, per voter. There's $1 per voter. Let's see if we can make it 15 cents per voter. $10.
Okay. Yeah, I was going to say.
Well, let's
turn out.
Well, let me just see. Okay. Let's see. Well, let's shoot for 15 cents per voter. And that's why you should all feel really relieved when the mayor comes back from his vacation.
Yeah. The budget's done.
Yeah, that's true.
When math skills have returned.
My little decimal point.
We don't have to worry about
my that. Decimal point dysfunction. So. And so in that respect, I think that that's true. That's roughly how many registered voters we have per voter.
Yeah, not the 20,000 actual voters.
Right. So I do hope that I've explained this to a number of constituents who have all said this seems like a frivolous waste, and I can think of no thing that's even farther from that. I think this is really critical expense. So, and I'm prepared to defend that. So, with that said, any further discussion on this item? Was there a motion?
No.
Move to approve.
Okay, motion's made and seconded, just in case. Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. I'll accept a motion to suspend rule.
Suspend rule for a second.
Motion's made and seconded to suspend the rules to allow for a second reading. Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? I'll accept a motion.
To approve.
Motion's made and seconded to put that on the floor. So any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. If summon Councilor O'Donnell from streetlights. There he is. Okay. Next up, okay, we're rotating councilors out. item 16.134. This is an order for the home rule petition to authorize the mayor to seek special legislation to amend the acts of 1994, Chapter 86.
Move to approve.
Motion's made, seconded. Further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell's out. Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. Well, that passes in first reading. There's a request for two.
Suspend rules.
Second.
Motion made, seconded to suspend rules. Any discussion? All those in favor of suspending rules, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made, seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Now, item D, number 15.382. This is, we're being revisited by this at our own request. This is an order regarding sick time. This is to accept the Mass General Law, Chapter 149, Section 148C. The item was postponed from February 4th, 2016 meeting, and it's it was for the City Council to consider for referring to committees. You recall this is actually this is the last election actually where there was a ballot initiative that was passed pretty substantially, and there was the reason that this item was postponed was because there were a number of ducks that needed to get in or be gotten in a row, particularly relative to collective bargaining that had to occur in order before this enacted. First, I'll accept a motion and put this on the floor.
Second.
Seconded. And the mayor is here to speak to this item too as well.
Yeah, I think back when you were last discussing this in January or February, I had asked if we could defer till July when we had finished all of our collective bargaining. I was clearly optimistic because we still have not finished our collective bargaining. We've had delays due to some changes in bargaining units. I know the school is still working on their collective bargaining. So I know my hope was to be able to provide you with an update. I can tell you that as part of collective bargaining, we are trying to incorporate the new changes to the law into all of our bargaining agreements. So my hope is that I'll be able to give you a report on that. So that was the reason why I had asked for some time, because the vast majority of our employees are members of bargaining units. So even if the law were enacted, we'd still have to make changes to our collective bargaining agreements. So we're in the process of doing that now, and I'd be able to give you an update once we finish those contracts to let you to give you a clearer picture of how the city is in terms of complying with these rules and regulations. And again, as I always point out, we have sick leave, and we have provided sick leave, and actually more generous sick leave than the law requires. And so if there's anyone out there who thinks that we're not providing sick leave, you know, in many cases, this law was designed to get at businesses that were not providing sick leave, but most public employees do have sick leave benefits, so.
I'll defer to the sponsor of the.
I would suggest either we postpone it until September or October, or we park it in the Finance Committee. At, you know, it could be brought out at any time that we wish. I'm certainly happy.
If you, and then send it back to Finance, when the mayor tells us the agreements are all done, then bring it back. We'll watch it go by our agenda for a couple of months.
I think that's preferable. That allows us to be more reasonable.
Yes. So I move to refer it to Finance.
Second.
Okay. Motion's made to refer and seconded. Any discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Let's see. Oh, look, that's the end. Is there any new business? All right, and I have no new motions to convey, so I'll accept the motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you all very much. Have a good remainder of your summer, and we'll meet again.
1,000 things to sign.